welcome back. It is my makeshift basement in Guitar Interactive magazine. It's once again Dan Veall here again, and I am presenting to you the EBS Stanley Clarke Signature Preamp Pedal. Now, I'm just going to add a quick disclaimer before I get started. Because we're in lockdown, I'm not being able to do the full review that I'd usually like to, so we're going to have to cut things down a little bit, but that's not going to stop me going through the details about this pedal. It does mean, and I urge you, to go out and try the pedal yourself. Okay, so what have we got going on here? Right, well, if you don't know who Stanley Clarke is, pause this video, go and do your homework, and then come back. Okay, you're back? Great. Here we have the EBS Stanley Clarke pedal. This is a superb tool for those who are using acoustic instruments such as, of course, double bass. Now, unfortunately, because of lockdown, I don't have the space in here, or neither could I get hold of a full-size double bass and all the other gubbins I need to go with it in order to make the review suitable with double bass. I am using here instead a Gillett Guitars prototype, and instead I'm going to be running off the piezo pickup off the bass for the remainder of the review. The pedal itself is split up into two separate channels. The great thing about this preamp pedal is actually, aside from using it with double bass, you can use it with any instrument, acoustic or electric. And you have two separate channels that you can actually run, as I say, completely separately. Across the top line, we have a master volume here. I've actually turned the master volume all the way down because this services the output that would go to an amplifier. But actually, I'm running from the DI output on the top of the pedal, and that's going straight into my recording device, making a really, really awesome front-end preamp for that too. We have bass boost and cut, a semi-parametric mid-frequency control, a filter knob with dual functions. We can either switch it to high-pass filter, which is really, really suitable for getting rid of low-end rumble off stage. If you're getting a lot of sub-rumble, you can actually dial that out without affecting the rest of your bass tone. Or flicker switch, and it takes us into notch mode. This is also very, very useful if you are suffering from feedback because you have an amplifier on stage to hear your acoustic instrument. Sometimes you'll get a howling or whiffing sort of sound, and you can dial that out by using the notch filter to locate that frequency which is causing the problems and just pull it back a little bit. Treble control on the right hand side there, and a master gain control for that particular channel. And it's the same story for channel number two underneath. What splits the two channels up is that the top channel has the ability to accept a signal from either the quarter inch input on the right hand side or from a balanced input from a microphone. So if you're using a microphone that requires phantom power or anything like that, you don't need separate boxes. Plug it in, switch it to XLR mode over here, and you're going to get power to your microphone and a really nice clean signal into the studio grade preamp pedal. On channel number two, you can run into the input available for that channel also on the right hand side of the pedal. And whereas you can use a quarter inch input, you can also switch that to run an electric microphone as well. So if you're using one of those with your acoustic instrument, then actually you can flick the switch and then that will provide the necessary power to that. Or if you're using just an electric instrument, bass guitar, for example, switch it to the off mode and away you go on the quarter inch input. Superb having two separate channels. But we also have the ability to combine the two channels as well. So for the benefit of the review that I'm doing, because I'm only using one input, I've actually combined the two. So I'm going through one channel and then into the next channel in serial, not parallel. So I can actually make use of double the set of controls, and that's exactly what I've done in setting up the sound for this particular instrument. Specifically, I've gone for a very flat sound off the instrument with not a great deal of character, and then, as you can see by my settings here, I've added in lots of mids to bring the sound of this instrument out. Now, physically, another reason why I'm not using a microphone is the design of this instrument is that actually, acoustically, it's very quiet. So there was no point putting a microphone in front of it anyway. But we do have, as I say, a piezo element in here, and that allows me to send out an acoustic kind of sound out to the preamp, and then I say further accentuate the sound. So this is what it sounds like with the settings and no drums. And I can easily go in and dial away or add sound that I want. So maybe I want a bit more of a rumbling low end. I'm going to use just the top channel for now. By boosting on both, it will actually add, and you'll get twice as much boost. So one at a time is fine. Here we go. Now, you're only going to hear the benefit of that if you're listening on decent earphones or decent speakers. Sorry, I bang on about that all the time, but you know, if you're listening through laptop speakers, they just don't have the low end, and double bass is pretty much lost on it, okay? So let's move on. I'm going to have a quick dial in of some sounds on the mid-range knob. As you can see here, we have got a frequency setting and a gain knob. This means I can actually dial in, and I want some of that lovely woody mid-range. So I've dialed that in already. Let's see what happens if I pull that out. I'm gonna get a really scoopy sort of sound instead. Here we go. Yeah, and it's sounding more subby now. It's sounding a bit like it wants to get underneath some synth or drum kind of sounds. I really like that. It's nice, still very, very warm in sound as well. Okay, so what I want to do is I'm going to try and get to a situation where I'm getting a boomy sort of sound so I can show you the high pass filter. So I think what I'm going to do is I'm going to dial those mids back in, but I'm actually going to pull the low mids up. So I'm going to try and make it a bit boomy on purpose. And I'm going to just filter it back out again, which seems like an odd thing to do, but I don't have a big boomy wooden stage to be playing on to demonstrate this. So we're just going to try and simulate it. Yeah, loads and loads of low end. I can actually feel the table vibrating in here because I've got quite a lot of low end coming through my monitors. Now, what I can do is, with the high pass filter dialed in, I can actually start pulling some of that very low end away. So this is with it turned off. And I'm going to progressively bring it in, and you should hear the bottom end slowly being scooped away. Now that's too much. I mean, that's taking everything away altogether, but let's hear it anyway. I can't imagine ever using that, but it kind of gives you that I'm listening on the end of an old phone kind of sound, or almost that sort of megaphone sort of sound. So that's too much, but at least you can see, hear rather, what I'm doing to the sound. Let's go and find a sweet spot. I think that's about it. So I'm actually negating the bass boost that I'm putting on. I wouldn't really do that in reality. I would leave everything a little flatter. But it demonstrates that even with lots and lots of low end going into the pedal, I can actually scoop it back away and control it. This gives me a tighter sound on stage, probably help me sit in the mix a little bit, and probably keep the engineer happy if he's running a system where there are like subs and things like that in a smaller venue. Very nice indeed. Now, of course, I could actually use the second channel to start dialing in frequencies as well. So let's get back where we were with the mids. I'm gonna pull the high pass filter down. And actually what I'm gonna do is, because I've got the high pass filter on channel A, I can't use the notch at the same time. So, well, let's have a look at what happens if I switch the notch on channel two, because I'm running these in series, remember? And we'll see if we can notch out some frequencies on this particular instrument. I don't think it's going to work so well because this is completely the wrong environment for it. Let's give it a go. Let's see what happens. So I'm going to take my A string and I'm just going to dial the filter round. Think you're going to hear, because actually what I've done is I've managed to tailor the sound through my speakers in the room and you're not hearing them. So I would say this is going to be something to go out and try in the field and get a better idea of what it can do. But certainly what it's doing is notching out frequencies that can be a bit problematic with feedback and the like on stage. Treble control, I've left that flat on one channel and just a little bit off on the other. The piezo pickups can be a little bit bright sounding. Certainly cheaper models can actually sound a bit more abrasive as well. So sometimes being able to bring that control down a little bit will actually smoothen things out a bit. So let's put it all the way down. Let's get a really, really soft sound. There we go. What you will immediately notice is it's tailored. So the top end, I haven't pulled that down and gone into, you know, palm muted electric bass kind of sound at all, have I? It's still got a clarity to it. Let's listen to that again. But I can quite quickly add in a little bit of clack if that's the kind of thing I want, especially if I'm playing, say, slap on a double bass and I want that nice clicky sound. I could dial that in on whichever preamp I wanted that top end percussive sound to be added to. And I could hear that coming through nicely. Now, if I was using, I think it's called a click plate or something like that, double bass players. I don't play double bass myself, but there is a little kind of percussive device, shall we say. And if you had a microphone near that, or if you're finding a way of getting the sound of that to come through your gear, actually having two separate channels means that you can dial that in separately and actually leave the bass tone alone. So there we go, we've got some basic settings to look at on here, and hopefully you've been able to hear some of the things that the pedal is capable of doing. Round the outside of the pedal then, let's look at some of the connections. As I said, we've got the ability to mix or switch between the two channels. There's a little switch on the side here which changes the functionality of the pedal. For further details, go and check out the manual. It's got lots of detail in about all the different configurations that the pedal is capable of doing. If I go through every single one of those, we'll be here all day. It's that good. Foot switch to go with that, and I can switch between one channel or the other channel, or switching the second channel in to combine, for example. Mute switch over here, so that is brilliant. I can just switch on the mute and I can unplug my instrument and safely stow it out the way in a drinks break or whatever it might be, without any clicks and bangs or anything like that being sent out to your amp or PA. Speaking of which, as I mentioned earlier on, you've got a balanced DI output here, and that can go to your recording device or, as I said, front of house, PA. We've also got a mic input here. This is the one I was talking about earlier on with the 48 volt phantom power. Either side, we have a headphone jack, so for quiet private practice. And there's also an auxiliary in as well. Power comes in the form of a supplied adapter. Thank you for adding that in the box as well, EBS. That's absolutely brilliant. I like to see that. Around the side, we've got a tuner output. So connecting your external tuner pedal, connect it right there. Effects loop. So if you like using effects or any other outboard processing, maybe you want to put a compressor in or something like that, we have an effects loop here which can run in series or parallel mode. Now this is running through one single jack, but EBS do these great little Y leads that allow you to utilize one jack for both the send and the return. And the Y lead has the send and return jacks on either end that you can plug into your external devices. Output jack here, this is going out to your amplifier. And finally, just to top it all off, we've got a ground lift on the balance line output, and also we have a speaker simulator on the XLR output, on the balance line output. I've had this switched in, and actually what I will say about this speaker emulator is it is very subtle. It only just shapes the sound. It's not something crazy like, you know, you're trying to get it to sound like a vintage rock bass cabinet or something like that. It really just does tailor the top end and bottom end just a little bit, just tighten up the sound a little bit. So there we go. As I said, a quick tour of the brand new Stanley Clarke acoustic preamp. I think you'll like it. If you're a double bass player, I think the features on board are absolutely fantastic, especially if you're using piezo pickups or something like that. This is a 10 megohm input impedance, so you're not going to get any of that annoying loading that some pedals put on your devices, on your pickups, which can sometimes affect the sound, especially the top end. So there we go. Let's round it up. Thanks for watching. This is the EBS Stanley Clarke acoustic preamp pedal.